our guests and visitors and wish you the Lord's richest blessing on your worship with us today. Before we begin, just a couple of things. If you don't want to take communion at the rail, make sure you have your wine and host with you. And we'll do, the people that have these will take communion first, and then the rest of you can come up and the ushers will guide you up to the altar rail. So if you didn't, if you would like to and you forgot to pick one up, you can do that during the first gift, okay? Or raise your hand and the usher can bring you some. Let's see, the next thing is the introit. We're not going to be singing the introit. So what we'll be doing is we'll be reading that by whole verse. So I'll read one verse and then you read one verse. And then the other thing is our ushers will be taking up an offering. And of course that will be done before the auditorium. So I think that's all the announcements I have. So I'd ask you now to please rise and we'll begin our worship by singing our opening hymn.
In the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said,
I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy and innocent of your sufferings and death, of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Let's now take a few moments of silent private confession. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead, and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart.
Commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act.
He will bring forth your righteousness as the light, and your justice as the noonday.
Be still before the Lord, and wait patiently for him. Fret not yourself over the one who prospers in his way, over the man who carries out evil devices.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart.
In your infinite grace, you have forgiven our Testament reading for today comes from the prophecy of Jeremiah, the 11th chapter. The Lord made it known to me, and I knew, that you showed me their deed. But I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter. I did not know it was against me. They devised schemes, saying, "Let us destroy the fruit with its, the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, that his name be remembered no more." But O Lord of hosts, who judges righteously, who tests the heart and the mind, let me see your vengeance upon them, for to you I have committed my cause. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And please read the gradual with me. Fear the Lord, you his saints, but those who fear him lack nothing. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. In our epistle reading, which will be part of our sermon for today, is taken from the letter of James, the 3rd chapter. Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And a host of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. What causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? You desire and do not have, so you murder. You covet and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions. You adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you suppose it is no purpose that the Scripture says, "He yearns jealously over the Spirit that he has made to dwell in us. But he gives more grace." Therefore it says, "God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise, if you are able, for the reading of our gospel. The gospel reading for today, which will serve as the basis for our sermon, is taken from the gospel of Mark, the 9th chapter, beginning with the 30th verse. Jesus did not want anyone to know, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And when he is killed, after 3 days, he will rise. But they did not understand the saying, and they were afraid to ask him. And they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you discussing on the way?" But they kept silent, for on the way, they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. And he sat down and called the 12, and he said to them, "If anyone would be first, he must be last of all, and servant of all." And he took a child and put him in the midst of them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever receives one such a child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. How many of us want to be the greatest? By the greatest, I mean the greatest spouse, or parent, or student, or boss, or worker, or athlete, or leader, or disciple of Jesus. Likewise, how many of us want to be the most important? The most important in our families, in our school classes, on our athletic teams, in our work groups, in our civic organizations, or even in our congregation. Now, I didn't see any hands go up, because maybe like Jesus' disciples in our gospel for today, maybe we're a little ashamed to confess that sometimes we like being the greatest and the most important in our relationships, or at least to be considered that way. Or maybe we were a little embarrassed to admit that we would like to know sometimes that all of our dedication, all of our efforts are recognized, and that we are hurt and maybe even offended sometimes when they're not. So if we struggle with those feelings to some degree, we shouldn't be surprised, because those are the effects of sin on our human nature and pride, which we have to contend with every day. And then we have the influence of celebrities in our society, like actors and athletes and trainers and experts of all kinds, who contend that they are the first, the greatest, the most important, and the best in their fields. And they encourage us to follow their example so that we can be successful no matter what it takes. However, as Christians, we know that the world's ideas about greatness are totally opposite of our Heavenly Father's concept of greatness. And from our own sad experience, we know that the world's way of obtaining greatness only causes more divisions, more strife, more harm, and more room in our relationships, in our families, in our organizations, in our associations, and sadly, even sometimes, in the church, in our congregation. And that is why James wrote in his epistle for today, probably to congregations who were experiencing dissension, but if you have jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it, as many people today boast, right, about it, and be false to the truth. And there are lots of people in our society that don't believe in absolute truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. And I think that is very evident in our society, with all the violence, with the sexual immorality, with racism, with abortion, and everything else that's going on. Well, according to our gospel reading for today, it seems that Jesus' disciples then were influenced by the world's ideas about greatness. And in fact, they had infiltrated into their culture and the teachings of their religious leaders, who considered themselves to be the elite of their society because of their traditions, and looked down on everyone else was less zealous than they were. So when Jesus asked his disciples what they were arguing about, they kept silent. For on the way, they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. Now, Mark doesn't tell us what they said, but we can assume that they were arguing about who was the greatest disciple, or who would be the most important disciple when Jesus, the Messiah, ushered in his kingdom. Maybe Peter argued that he was the most important because Jesus called him the Rock, because he confessed Jesus to be the Messiah, the Son of God. But maybe he conveniently left out that Jesus rebuked him because he rebuked Jesus for saying that he must go to Jerusalem to suffer and die and to be raised again. Maybe John and James argued that they were the most important because they were Jesus' favorite cousins, and because they had been given the privilege, along with Peter, to watch Jesus transfigured up on that mountain, and they heard the Heavenly Father's voice declare him to be his divine and beloved Son. And maybe the rest of them were just arguing that, you know, I cast out more demons than you did, or I performed more miracles than you did. But whatever they were arguing about, they kept silent. Because I think deep down inside, they were afraid, because Jesus was going to be calling them to account for what they thought and why they argued. And of course, Jesus, being God, already knew what they were saying. But he sat down and he taught them who is the greatest in his kingdom. Not based on the world's standards, not based on their concepts of what they thought the Messiah or his kingdom should be, but rather upon God's word. And Mark recorded this in his gospel because we are disciples of Jesus. So he is not just teaching his disciples then, he is also teaching us now. And that's why James also wrote, "The wisdom that comes from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere." And that certainly describes Jesus, who the scriptures say is wisdom from above, is God's wisdom. So what Jesus did, he took this child and he taught his disciples and teaches us the real meaning of greatness. And according to Mark, he took a child, that Greek word is a little child, and put him in the midst of them. And taking him in his arms, he said, "Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. And whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me." Now, I think that Jesus chose a little child because at that time, a child was on the low end, was on the bottom rung of their scale of importance in their culture. And they didn't have any influence, except maybe in their own family, and maybe only according to their birth order. And even today, when we look at our society, we see that children cannot advance our careers. Children cannot enhance our prestige in our society at all. Unless, of course, maybe you're a nanny or a daycare worker, because there are so many people now, two family incomes, they have to work in order to survive. But in addition, children cannot do or contribute anything. And in fact, they need to be cared for And it takes a lot of time and effort and money to take care of children. And in fact, many people these days are refraining from having children. And even some having abortions because they don't want them getting in the way of their careers or their lifestyles. In fact, I just saw on Facebook this morning that a lot of our Olympic athletes, women, have had abortions. They were pressured to have abortions, and they did. And now they are suffering the effects of those abortions, of guilt and depression. Well, Jesus said that the greatest of his disciples are those who serve others, especially those who are weak and helpless, those who are not influential in any way, those who cannot contribute anything to our advancement or our prestige in society, but especially in God's kingdom. It means setting aside our own ambitions and our own desires based upon the world's selfish and self-centered concept of greatness, but instead serving others in Jesus' name in all of our relationships, whether it's our families, whether it's at school, whether it's in our workplaces, whether it's in our neighborhoods, our associations, or whatever relationship we might be in. And we know for ourselves, because of our sinful nature, our weak flesh, and the world, the only way we can do that is through the power of the Holy Spirit, who transforms our minds and transforms our hearts to God's will for us in Jesus, who equips us for service, gives us the resources so that we can serve others in Jesus' name, no matter how low we might be on the scale in our society. I think a good example is a story I read about Dwight Moody. Dwight Moody was considered one of the greatest evangelists in America back in the 19th century. For your kids, that's the 1800s. That's quite a few years ago. But he was hosting a Bible conference at a college in Massachusetts. And back in those days, especially, he was hosting these European pastors. And back in those days, especially in Europe, the custom was for people to leave their shoes out in the hallways at night. And the house servants would come by and at night, and they would clean and polish those shoes so that the next morning they would wake up and they would have clean and polished shoes. Well, Dr. Moody was walking down the hallways and he saw these shoes out there in the hallway. And of course, in America, you didn't have any servants to do that. But he did not want to embarrass his brother pastors. So he went to some of his students and told them the situation, but they all kind of begged out of it or made excuses or were silent. So Dr. Moody went back to the dormitory, collected all of the shoes, took him to his room and spent the night cleaning and polishing those shoes and then put them back. So the next morning, when the pastors came out, there were these clean and polished shoes, but they didn't know who did it because he didn't tell anybody that he did it. But it just so happened that one of his associates came to his room that night and saw him cleaning and polishing those shoes. So unbeknownst to Dr. Moody, he went and told some of the students what Dr. Moody, their teacher, had done. And so those students volunteered to do it themselves without telling anybody that they did it. So Dr. Moody was an example to those students, and he's an example to us, but there's an even better example, and that example is Jesus. And you might remember at that Last Supper that here is Jesus, our Lord and Savior, got down on his hands and knees and washed the feet of his disciples like an ordinary servant would do, because none of them would do it. And then he said to them, which also applies to us, "Do you understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet, for I have given you an example that you should do as I have done for you." And that may not mean literally washing each other's feet, but it does mean serving one another humbly, just as Jesus served us. Because Jesus humbled himself even more than that when he did what he told his disciples he would do, when he suffered many things, when he was rejected by the elders and chief priests, when he was crucified, and after 3 days rose again. And that is why we, as disciples of Jesus, do not have to compete against one another to be the greatest or the most important disciple. Because when you come right down to it, Jesus is the greatest. Jesus is the greatest of all. And Jesus loves us and gave his life for us and humbled himself even unto death, even where we are on that scale, so that we know that we have a place with him in heaven. Not because of what we've done, but entirely because of what he has done and his unconditional love and grace toward us, who are the lowest and the least. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep our hearts and our minds in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. In his precious name we pray, now and always. Amen. And I'd ask you now, if you are able, to please rise, and we will profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
Heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for our offering. Thank you.
us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For humility, that God, who opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble, would help us to submit to him and resist the devil, that he would flee from us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our synod's leaders and all pastors, that the Lord would give them the wisdom that comes down from above, making them peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere, and that they would sow among us in peace, yielding a harvest of righteousness. We especially lift up to your throne of grace all of our colleges, day schools, and seminaries, the teachers and students, that you may enlighten them and give them your wisdom which comes from above, that they may, in all their thinking and doing, fulfill the service that you have prepared for them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Holy Spirit would pacify our passions, and that he would not be ruled by the jealousy and selfish ambition that gives rise to disorder and every vile practice. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord would uphold this world in his order, for the church, that she would be defended from all enemies, for our homes, that the Lord would bless parents and children in service toward each other, and faith until life's end, and for the government, that God would grant all authorities help and wisdom, and for our congregation, especially during this call process, that you give us the confidence and peace to rest assured that you are working through our call committee, and you are working through them in order to lead us to the man, the pastor, that you have already chosen to lead us. Lord, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and those in any need, especially for Amy and Chip, Martha, Stella, Faith, Matt, Pam, Carrie, Diantha, Paul, Tammy, Jamie, Mary Lou, Jenna, Butch, Jason, Dawn, Susan, Judy, Michael, Matthew, Terry, John, Paul, Tom, the Woodard family, Julia, Liam, and Ted, and all those we name in our hearts now. That you will give them through your Holy Spirit healing, not only of body, but also of mind and spirit, and that you will bless all those who minister to them in your name. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who draw near to the altar today, that in repentance, with cleansed hands and purified hearts, we may receive Christ, who draws near to us in his body and blood. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord of hosts, grant that what we ask from you may not be squandered after our passion, but sought rightly in faith, that we may receive them and put them to service for you and for our neighbor. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty God. have been hidden from before the foundation of the world, you have made known to the nations in your Son. In him, being found in the substance of our mortal nature, you have manifested the fullness of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Take, drink, this is the true blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Christ shed on the cross for the forgiveness of all your sins. Now may the true body and blood of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith of the life everlasting, heart and history. would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Suggest who you would think would be a good pastor fit here. So, okay, then let's close by singing our closing hymn, Children of the Heavenly Father.